the beginning of organic chemistry. And the date is 1828, when a German chemist artificially synthesized urea, which is a waste part of urine. That doesn't sound like it would be subject to much commercial consequence, but it led to artificial fertilizers, because urea is nitrogen, and plastic, polyurethane. And when it happened, he said, "Urea, I found it." So organic chemistry was added to mathematical physics. And that's really, and in a way, somewhat subordinated to mathematical physics. I don't quite understand that myself, but that's how it's stated in the literature. And so that's what counts for knowledge. They took over, the physicists and the chemists. And the synthesis of urea was construed to be the refutation of vitalism. Vitalism was the point of view opposed to physicalism, that you can't reduce everything to matter and argue that matter is all that matters. You have to pay some respect to the integrity of organic nature. No, you don't. So, vitalists lost. And they lost on the basis of arguing that organic nature and all of its products exhibited life force, vital force. That was their, distinguishing term, which simply meant life. I mean, you found life in organic nature, didn't find life in the same way in inorganic nature or with respect to matter. Matter was dead. And so it was the loss of life in the refutation of vitalism. And that was fine with modern science because they wanted to reduce everything to dead matter in order to investigate it the way they do. So to celebrate the triumph of physicalism and the refutation of vitalism, they formed the Physicalist Society in Berlin to consolidate the gains of physicalism now that it had become victorious. And they took an oath. It was part of their social ritual. And they took the oath in blood. That was one of the strangest eye-openers in my pursuing this entire story. They took an oath in blood? Yeah. Well, first of all, why would physicalists take an oath if everything is reduced to matter in their view? What does an oath mean to them? What does loyalty mean to them? What does, they did. And that was, how obtuse they were about what they had achieved. Except for the fact that it was considerable. It was all-encompassing. And then the next major step from the physical society was the logical positivist school in Vienna, called the Vienna Circle. They use the term circle as the kind of technical term for a group of scientists, who even philosophers. And so the Vienna Circle was to further the physicalist program, to the point of calling the people in the circle working on the philosophy of physicalism. I mean, they were explicit about it. And they wanted to eliminate metaphysics, which is one of the aspects of our whole story. The whole Western philosophical tradition starts with the meditation on being versus non-being. Philosophy is thought to come out of a wondrous outcry. Why is there anything? Why is there anything not? It's a shock of non-being. So I probably should wait a little while until everybody gets here. I got started giving a review of the whole course.
Two questions. Can I borrow some of your time bomb there?
Yeah?
I want to rub some on my
I'm gonna pass it around. And for people to spray themselves.
I have a question for Nada. What are you gonna do? Are you gonna post these edit the videos and post them, or put them on his website, or what are you gonna do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
I mean, it's all about getting money. I mean, I also videotaped all of his other class, the last class he gave. I have all of those lectures also.
Is that available through the Ecotopia?
No.
You have your own website?
I don't have it online.
Okay.
I've just been archiving. I'm just...
Uh-huh. Right now you're just archiving.
Yes.
Okay.
So did you video me when I did the church talk on Jesus' occupation?
I asked you about that. We'll talk about that.
Okay. Well, yes
I
or
did.
No? You did. I thought you
if
did.
If I was there and I had my camera, then I did.
But I guess I can't remember if you were there.
I'm sorry.
I was there.
Yeah,
there was an opera singer saying at the beginning.
Yeah. Okay.
Can I get your address afterwards so I can contact you immediately?
Sure.
Okay, great.
If you go to ecotopia.org, you'll see a lot of my videos. I put a lot of videos up.
There's a lot of stuff on there.
Yeah.
I've been there, but I haven't really, I just perused it.
Yeah, so he was just on my radio show last week, did a fabulous, I thought it was a great interview.
It was.
Did you hear it?
Yeah.
Really? What was it about? My talk last night.
Herb time.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. How was dinner? How did it go last night?
I mean, it was fun.
Yeah.
It was at a full house. The only disconcerting moment when I was just really getting into it was for Bernie LeBouf, my pal, to look at me and go,
as he was walking out the door.
Time to quit. Oh, thanks, Bernie. I only have another hour to go. So, anyhow.
Were you holding up the meal, or was it during?
No, it was after.
Okay.
So, but it was a full house, and they were all in it, so it was fun.
There was sweetbreads. Everything on the menu had thyme in it.
They were so
first of all,
good.
It was the menu was for Paul, and it said it on it. I actually grabbed the menu. You have it right there.
Yeah.
What does it say at the top?
Tonight is Paul Lee's thyme.
And so show them the menu. It was delicious. Everything had thyme in it.
What was this for?
He had a salon last night at Gabriella's.
Oh, cool.
And
Paul, you're getting all the kids feeding, and you're getting the new classes, and you're getting late in life, but you're getting so
I knew I was a late bloomer. No, that was clear
he
all
gave
along.
He gave a TED talk, a TEDx Santa Cruz talk.
Yeah.
He was there.
But you were supposed to dedicate it to me, you said.
I have.
I was
I
all
will.
Excited, like, God, he's going to dedicate it. My wife was there, and I'm like, can I do that, right?
So Nada was part of the TED organizational group, and so she told me I should do a TED talk, and I did, and it was great. So that's on my website too.
I feel happy that you have managed to spread the idea of violism onto TED talks. I don't know about the political beliefs behind TED, but I'm glad you did it.
Well, it was a big discussion because as TEDx Santa Cruz, I mean, we can do whatever we want, but TED won't pick it up. And the whole point is to try to get our TED Talks picked up by TED, right? So we know that if we're going to be talking about metaphysics or being everything that Paul's talking about from the vitalist point of view, in comparison to the physicalism, TED has bitten into completely. And they censored Rupert Sheldrake. He gave a talk at TED and they took it down, which made it even more kind of popular because it was the first one that was taken down. And they're kind of explicit about not wanting to go into metaphysics. And so with Paul, we were really trying to find that sweet spot where we're both talking about getting our agenda across while fitting into the TED. And do we really, I mean, we don't necessarily want to fit into the TED thing. I mean, we're TEDx Santa Cruz, we've got our own brand, you know what I mean?
I like that we have diverse, we can have a, I like the idea of Santa Cruz having its own autonomy different from the other TED.
I so don't get how TED would be against the vitalist thing.
Yeah,
you think people that were in the TED, I love TED.
It was the reaction on the part of scientists about their giving Sheldrick a showcase.
It's all Sheldrick.
It was all a protest against Sheldrick.
I still don't get that
and they,
TED.
They knuckled under.
I don't get that people behind TED, and certainly a lot of the people that love TED, like I do, totally are against what they did to Sheldrick and don't understand how they could do that.
Yeah.
Are you on any social networks like Facebook or LinkedIn?
No, not
well.
Only when I have to be, and somebody sent me something.
If you did, then you would know. I brought this out before. I get in constant debates and arguments with the prevailing view on the social networks is the Dawkins, Hitchens, Sam Harris atheist.
Okay.
And you cannot deviate from their party line. And they got behind. They just got their all their panties in a bunch over Rupert Sheldrake, and they just pressured the TED people.
So he was already the most controversial scientist in Great Britain. I think it's easy to say. And when he published his first book, maybe 20 years ago, called A New Science of Life, I think is the title, it was reviewed by Science Magazine, the most prestigious scientific journal, and the reviewer was the editor of Science Magazine, and he said, this is my candidate for Bernie. Okay, so that's what started it.
That is just, that threatened.
No, but it's only because Rupert was the first neo-vitalist to go online with a neo-vitalist point of view.
Why is that so threatening to them?
That's what I don't understand either. 10 years ago for somebody in politics to come out of the closet.
That's why they took an oath in blood to consolidate the physicalist takeover. Now, if you guys want to read a formal account of this, it's called The Structure of Scientific Revolution by Thomas Kuhn, K-U-H-N. That was the cause celeb book when I came here to teach at Crown. We made it the text for the Crown College course. And it's a formal study of the physicalist vitalist takeover without his ever mentioning those two terms, because it's assumed. So he tells you how a scientific revolution occurred, and he must have had physicalism in mind because he was associated with the school of logical positivism in Vienna. I think they were partly responsible for publishing the book. There's some tie there. And he was a student of Conant, the president of Harvard, and the guy that helped run the smashing of the atom and the development of the bomb. And so Conant was famous for wanting to eliminate the divinity school. It didn't make any sense to him anymore for Harvard to continue supporting theological education when God is dead. I mean, hasn't everybody got the message from Nietzsche that's all over with? And that whole language is now to be eliminated and forgotten about, which was the slogan of the logical positivist school. The elimination of metaphysics, and clearly theology. They also included religious language and aesthetic language. You can't discuss beauty in any meaningful way. And ethical language. That was their program. So, Kuhn writes his formal study of the physicalist-vitalist conflict without mentioning this historic case, which would have so illuminated his study. There's a formal account of the revolution and its takeover. I wrote him a note one time saying, how come you didn't make reference to your perfect test case in discussing this? And I never heard back. It was funny because his book became one of the most popular and famous works within academia, and Harvard denied him tenure.
But he also gave us the word paradigm. Right?
Yeah, and
okay.
He's the one that coined the word paradigm.
Right. But then in that sense...
Paradigm.
The Kuhn guy?
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
But Paul, in that sense, isn't there kind of a silver lining to this book? Because didn't he relativize scientific worldviews, starting with, you know, Einstein overturning Newton, and show inherently that the contradictions within any certain scientific worldview, i.e. paradigm, would actually become overthrowing it at some point.
Yeah.
And so doesn't he kind of allow for a vitalist...
No, but he could say, just as physicalism overthrew vitalism,
right,
wait for the time when
exactly,
something...
Exactly, exactly. But he allows
coming.
For that. So maybe unbeknownst
yeah.
to him, he may have, you know, started something.
Yeah, that's true to say, I think.
Yeah.
And that's the odd conclusion I've come to, finishing the book and teaching this class and so on. Two specific works. One is called The Vital Machine. I've mentioned it here before. And it's a guy who tries to overcome the physicalist-vitalist conflict by saying, well, let's blend the language. Let's talk about vital machines. And, you know...
At least it's more inclusive.
And, you know, yeah, I know, but it doesn't work. he tries it. He says, let's use the word bionic and make that the key word for reconciling this conflict. Bionic? I mean, all I get is a kind of, you know, mechanical hand out of that one. And so it's a very interesting study. I didn't even want to read it because I was repulsed by the title and the effort. But it turns out to be a remarkable review of the history of science in the physicalist tradition and then vitalism. So he goes through the thing very well and comes out with this stuff. And a great bibliography, too. Okay, that's that one. Then I told you about this philosopher, Strawson, who proposes that physicalism entails panpsychism. That just means everything is conscious. Including matter? Yeah. Why leave that out? You could say it's potentially conscious, because it finally gets to consciousness, so there's something ingredient or resident in matter that you can follow through an evolutionary course. Anyhow, that knocks me out of my chair. I don't know what to do with this guy. And it's a little bit like the vital machine. You know, okay, I guess you can say anything you want, just when you assume that nobody could say anything like that. And then here it comes. So there's a whole big debate now about whether physicalism entails panpsychism and how you exclude consciousness from anything when you can't quite tell what it is anyhow and where it enters.
How's this called? Quantum vitalism.
Yeah. And there is such a view. You know, that's another thing. Okay. So back to the review. So we started with Galileo, and he's the father of physicalism, and he mathematizes nature. Good for you, pal. And that sets up the whole show. And what you got to think of in his doing that is a missile. Because once you mathematize nature, you can figure out how you get your missile from here to there in terms of blowing up anybody. And that's exactly what they did. That was the beginning of the development of missiles. Because you could figure out a trajectory. It's amazing. Okay, so I made a thing, it's a little bit eccentric, in thinking that Galileo should have been burned at the stake instead of Bruno, and I'm foolish for proposing that.
Why Bruno?
Well, Bruno was burned at the stake. So I'd like to sacrifice Galileo instead of Bruno. I mean, somebody had to be burned. It should have been Galileo, not Bruno. Bruno simply was a pan-vitalist. I mean, he thought the universe. He thought everything was infinite. I mean, he opened up to the whole Copernican revolution about the infinity of worlds. He's a very interesting figure. So he was a pantheist, let's say. And the church didn't like that, so they burned him. Well, what Galileo did was to undermine the sacrament, known as the Eucharist, the transformation or transubstantiation of the bread and wine into the body and blood of Jesus Christ, the high point of the Roman Mass, when the priest effects this magical transubstantiation. If you want to see it, look at the painting by Raphael on the Eucharist. And he's actually painted it. I mean, it's one of the most stunning paintings in the history of art. And he actually captures the magical moment of the transubstantiation. And it's a very famous painting. Okay, so Galileo was an atomist, which meant a materialist. He was influenced by the poem of Lucretius that had just been discovered in the Renaissance, and it had a big influence on him because it went back to Democritus and ancient atomism. Ha ha! We can reduce everything to atoms as the smallest part. We can be materialists and work with atoms. And they're very amenable to mathematics. Sonia, that's what Galileo adopted, and the church was against it because it undermined the doctrine of transubstantiation and the transformation of the elements. And that's, I think, why they put him under house arrest. They struck a bargain. Okay, shut up about Copernicus. Just say it's a theory, and we won't burn you at the stake. And if you do that, we'll kind of forget about your being an atomist. Because if you're under house arrest, you're not going to be all that effective for that point of view anyhow. Yeah, something like that. So Galileo is a real interesting figure. And the reason I picked that up is because Chadwick, in the garden here, reintroduced students to a sacramental relation to nature. Okay? He worshipped nature. He knew it was God's gift. And he treated it accordingly. He reverenced what he did. And students were looking for that. Especially if you took acid. And you saw eternity in a grain of sand, right? So they staggered around here wondering where, And so Chadwick, who wasn't an acid head by any means, nevertheless, with his sacramental relation to nature, initiated students into that point of view, and that's what they were looking for. They wanted to get out of industrial society. They didn't want to go to school to become servants of industrial society. They didn't want to be cogs in the machinery of production and consumption. Ta-da! They wanted to go back to nature and commune its organic basis. And that's what Chadwick showed them. So I had to kind of figure out, where did that come from? And what is the sacramental relation to nature? What is the sacrament? You know, baptism, where the water becomes a sacramental delivery point. And ordination, that's considered a sacrament. The laying on of hands and the transmission of the priestly, substance of the church tradition. So, when I found out about Galileo being a materialist and an atomist, and it was the beginning of the reduction of things to matter, I thought, there it is. That's a signal point in overcoming a view that nature is somehow, in some sense, sacred. That was the end of that. And it set up the ability to exploit it and manipulate it for one's purposes. And we made something of Francis Bacon. Barry was keen about him. I'm sorry, I had an original edition of a Francis Bacon I wanted to bring to show you in the class, and I lent it out. But Francis Bacon was the great spokesman for the physicalist turn and the victory and triumph of modern science, paving the way to physicalism in the 19th century. Francis Bacon is in the 16th century, and he calls it the Great Instauration. I mean, we are now going to supplant the ancients as moderns, and we're going to go ahead and take nature by force. And that's what has come into our hands by virtue of the power that we can now yield. And he just puts it straight like that. So it became kind of manifesto for the eventual development of industrial society. So then we went to Descartes. You know, Descartes gives the whole kind of philosophical foundation for physicalism, the subject-object split, and really is the first to describe the scientific method. I mentioned how Galileo eliminated secondary qualities, which had everything to do with the person in his and her subjective life. They weren't amenable to mathematical determination, so therefore you remove all secondary properties. And Descartes carried that through with the thinking self, the cogito, over and against extended objects. So you get a kind of lifeless universe with Descartes, and you have a mind that comprehends it and figures it out. So then you go to Newton, and it's the complete follow-through of Galileo, and a clockwork mechanical universe, and the mechanization of the world picture, and it sets up the whole industrial revolution and the triumph of the machine over artisanal handwork. Okay, so then the next step, as I've detailed it, is the artificial synthesis of urea. That was a smoking gun for me. I had to find the point where it really hit home, and that was with synthetic urea as a fertilizer and plastics. I mean, it couldn't have been more symbolic of the physicalist takeover and the elimination of vitalism and everything that's alive. It's when life became a quandary, big time.
That's, why not hemp? It regenerates, it's a very much regenerable crop. You could continue to build infinite supplies. Why not hemp?
Well, they do in Canada. Canada doesn't have the restrictions that we do in this country. It's all because of marijuana. I mean, it became the big bugbear. They're now starting to wonder about Colorado and Denver because little kids are getting a hold of marijuana cookies.
And also, it was also Vermont.
Huh?
Vermont.
There's an editorial, you know, what's her name? The great woman editorial writer.
Arianna Huffington?
I don't know. In the New York Times.
Oh, New York Times.
Oh,
who?
Gosh.
You know, the funny one.
Down.
Maureen Down.
Yeah. Well, she has a column this morning on going to Denver to kind of interview people about marijuana and so on. And she gets a cookie or some kind of a candy bar. And so she eats it and flips out for about 10 to 12 hours. I mean, curls up in a fetal position. She thinks she's going to die. They're going to come and take her away. And she gets a whole paranoid. Yeah, she has a bad trip.
Well,
and
she
might
bad.
Influence her writing a little bit.
So she details that and then mentions the problem of kids getting into, you know, the supply and not knowing any better. Okay. So
also,
the hemp business comes off of the psychoactive properties of marijuana, so you can't even grow non-psychoactive hemp because, you know, if you chewed on the rope long enough, you might get a little buzzy.
85 feet of rope all at once.
And also,
I understand that the hemp industry was stopped by the paper industry and that
it
was it
could
the
be. Sure,
lumber
I
companies
doubt it.
That pushed
yeah.
it into the ground. Specifically,
in that book, Smoke Signals, that we're reading, you know, by Martin Lee,
yeah.
Smoke Signals, it had to do a lot with the Hearst Company owning paper mills.
Yeah.
So they used their newspapers to follow Harry Anslinger's, you know, so all of Harry Anslinger's myths were propagated by the Hearst papers because the Hearst papers had paper mills.
So why'd you bring that up?
Because hemp is a has biodegradable oil, has biodegradable plastic. It's a renewable source.
So
life.
What did that have to do with what I was saying?
Urea and plastic?
Huh?
You talked about plastic.
Urea and plastic is polluting, killing, death.
Okay, got it.
And also, I noticed that there is one article that features the spiritual aspects of mathematical properties such as Fibonacci, the torus field, the vector equilibrium, Metatron's cube.
Yeah, really?
Yes.
I don't know anything about that.
Well, mathematics,
yeah,
I'm familiar with the patterns and stacking
them on top
of each other.
So would you see that as vitalistic? Why not? I mean,
they're commonly used to make churches, spiritual temples.
Okay.
Chaos theory and the spirals, everybody probably you can see the vitalism in mathematics.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if it's, I don't know, isn't that kind of like hypocritical of itself? If it's like a mathematical pattern, then wouldn't that be taking away the vitalistic part of it?
There is a tradition of what you could call vitalist math going back to Plato.
And geometry.
And the forms, so people who are Platonists in mathematics, I think would be partial to vitalism.
Hmm.
As opposed
to Penrose is.
Yeah, and Gödel was. So Gödel was a Platonic mathematician, and my pal Ralph Abraham here is.
So they're not mutually exclusive.
No. And Ralph is as good an example of a vitalist mathematician as I could find, and he's one of my closest intellectual colleagues. And he was a close friend and colleague of Rupert Sheldrake. I mean, he, in effect, discovered Rupert, thought he was the greatest thing since French cheese, and has conducted trilogues with Rupert and Terence McKenna, who was considered to be the successor to Timothy Leary. And they conducted these trilogues at Esalen, and they have three volumes. So they have three volumes of that, anyhow.
It was on YouTube, too.
Yeah.
They videotaped one at Esalen.
So look up Ralph Abraham and Terence McKenna.
Rupert Sheldrake, Ralph Abraham, and Terence McKenna.
See, and now what Rupert, just to bring it up to date, has just published this book called The Science Delusion in its British title. And Science Set Free in its American title. I don't know why he couldn't use it here, because he goes up against Dawkins and that camp of atheists to argue against the whole physical schmear. It's explicitly his theme in this last book, The Science Delusion. And I thought, oh, Rupert, fantastic. I can't believe that you should do a companion piece to what I tried to set out in the Chadwick book. So he delineates the dogmas of physicalism and then sets about to show all kinds of other phenomena that refute being so doctrinaire about physicalism and so hostile to anything that smacks of vitalism. It's amazing. I still don't get it, why there should be this scientific hostility to the vitalist point of view.
And then that's what got taken down by Ted. Because that's what
Rupert
Sheldrake was
talking about.
That was his TED talk.
So you couldn't get more symptomatic expressions of the conflict than these kinds of examples we're giving you.
And then, talking about mathematical vitalism, there's the Platonic and Pythagoras mathematics has to do with music and the music of the spheres. Hence the book Gödel, Escher, Bach, how even music can be mathematized.
Yeah.
It doesn't take away its beauty, doesn't take away its life force, doesn't take away its poetry. I know you can look at it mathematically, but that doesn't take away if you're willing to be inclusive about it. But that's being pretty generous too.
See, the turning point comes to mind now. It was Poincaré, a French mathematician, who was one of the most brilliant mathematicians 100 years ago. And Ralph follows in his tradition because he worked on the math of dynamics, fluid math, and so that would almost necessarily have a vitalist aspect to it. And that's what Ralph's concern is. So Poincaré is a good point of departure for picking up that thread. And it led to chaos math, which Ralph is one of the founders of. So that's very vitalist as far as I'm concerned. the math of chaos and fractals and the whole development from that, which Ralph pioneered. So Ralph's been a great colleague as far as, you know, talking about this stuff together. I failed high school geometry, and I was always sort of embarrassed about that. And my left brain is more or less dead.
You're too much of an idealist, Paul.
I know, because I'm left-handed, so I have great intuitive powers and associative powers. I'm somewhat proud of that, but I just couldn't do math. I couldn't do science. I went to college as a pre-med student because my father was a doctor. I was the only child. His office was in our home, and it was inevitable that I would pursue medicine, thanks to his influence and his hope. Well, I took chemistry in college, and the teacher called me in and said, Lee, if you drop your pre-med interest, you know, maybe you should go into philosophy, and I'll give you a C. And I said, okay. So that's how that happened. And so then we got down to urea. We got down to the Physical Society in Berlin, where it just is so illustrative.
When was the Physical Society?
About 10 years after urea.
Okay, and then the logical positivist?
They're toward the end of the 19th century, let's say 1890. And then right over the century into the early part of the 20th century. And the important figures that came out of that were Wittgenstein and Gödel. And Wittgenstein said, philosophy is the disease of which it should be the cure. And he's talking about the logical positivists. And he got sick of them. So he kind of bought the program as far as tightening up philosophical language. He was really amazing for that, and people esteemed him for that. But he didn't want to eliminate metaphysics. He didn't want to eliminate what the logical positivists he did. He wanted to keep quiet. So a famous saying of his was, whereof one should not speak, one should be quiet. Shut the fuck up. And so there's this mystical aspect of Wittgenstein that makes him attractive. And so he's a hard-headed dude. I never could get much with him, very far with him. Very difficult to read. And he was very imperious. Nobody could talk in his presence. He did all the talking. And one of his favorite outbursts was something about...
Popper.
Huh?
Popper.
Wittgenstein.
Close to the fireplace with the...
Yeah,
right. He
was a force. Everybody was afraid of him. And he was just, you know, menacing in his intelligence and his ferocity and the fact that he took up all the oxygen in the room. And then the other guy, Gödel, is one of my heroes, which I've talked about a little bit here, who came out of the logical positive school and who developed what are called the incompleteness theorems and the undecidability problem. What he did was to pick up the old ancient theme, Epimenides the Cretan said all Cretans are liars. And it's called the Cretan riddle or the Cretan. Yeah. So, I mean, is Epimenides telling the truth or is he lying? It sounds so dumb on the face of it. I don't understand how it got to be such a classic philosophical puzzle. But anyhow, Gödel picked it up and said, well, this is true mathematics. You can't tell whether Epimenides is lying or not any more than you can tell if a mathematical set is complete or not. There's always an undecidable point in every mathematical set. I don't know what to say beyond that to make it any clearer, but that's what he did. And in a way, he undermined the foundation of mathematics in his undecidability and completeness theorems. And it was a huge shock to mathematics. The logical positivist kind of went, well, you know, who asked you? You know, like, why don't you go to Princeton and hook up with Einstein and just get out of Vienna? Which he did. So it was extremely difficult to assimilate what Gödel meant. If you want a fabulous book, Manuel mentioned, it's called Gödel, Escher, Bach by Hofstetter. And that'll give you a wonderful introduction to Gödel and a great description of Escher, you know, the guy that did these wonderful prints, you know, fish.
The optical illusion prints.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Distorted geometric realities.
And then he associates it with the music of Bach. So it's that was another kind of tour de force book that became a cause to live in the academic underworld, and that's a good place to start. It's you know, it was 50 years ago when it came out.
It's not an easy read.
Huh?
Wasn't an easy read for me.
No,
especially the Escher and Bach stuff was a lot easier to follow than the Gödel stuff.
Yeah, I know it. Gödel's difficult. And I told you, I had a big thing about Gödel because I was told by a mathematician friend here, Jay Greenberg, that Gödel had formulated a proof for the existence of God. And at the time, I was trying to do a journal for the History of Consciousness program here. I was worried about getting tenure because I had a lot of enemies here, which I couldn't kind of figure out. And so I wrote to Gödel and asked him if he would send me his proof for the existence of God because I knew I'd get tenure if I published it in my journal. And he said it was incomplete.
It's undecided.
Okay, so I missed on that one. Okay, then, so that's kind of the culmination of the physicalist tradition with the school of logical positivism. Then things started to kind of crack up.
Perhaps so, I could try the sparkling mineral water?
Yeah, would you like one?
Sure.
Okay. So you have quantum physics coming in, even though it's still, I couldn't really figure out where you might pinpoint a neo-vitalist turn within science. So quantum physics never quite struck me as a candidate.
The uncertainty principle.
Huh?
It would be probably in the uncertainty principle.
Yeah. So that's the point. I thought of that, and also the principle of complementarity. So you get some themes in modern physics that are interesting and enticing. When Heisenberg, I guess it is, he did the principle of complementarity, didn't he?
Uncertainty
and complementarity.
Maybe I know uncertainty. I'm not sure about
complementarity. But I think complementarity too, because he wanted to show how the experimenter influences the experiment.
Right.
That came through those guys. Because they, up to then, were just trying as hard as they could to make what they were doing objective. See? Devoid of any subjective element. Totally objective. You know, replicable, blah, blah, blah. Well, Heisenberg said, no, 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 the experimenter influences the experiment, no matter how objective they try to be. And he came and gave a talk at MIT, and the buzz went around Cambridge. I was there then. Did he use the theme of love to talk about the complementarity principle? And it's kind of a reciprocal thing. You know, like everybody in Cambridge was like, did you hear what Heisenberg said? He's talking about love. So that was fun to pick that up and be a witness to it. So anyhow, in the book, it became an issue for me to think of the physicalist blows to vitalism as a number of nails that were to hammer in the lid on the coffin of vitalism. They wanted to bury it. So the corpse of vitalism is put in this coffin, and they hammered down the lid with successive nails. The physicalist society, the Vienna Circle, the smashing of the atom, reductive behaviorism, the elimination of consciousness. I even included psychedelics as this, you know, the artificial synthesis of mysticism. Or insanity, you can take your pick. It was a big issue at Harvard with Leary, and he tried to change it or, you know, divert it from what had already taken place, namely, psychedelics are psychotomimetic. They imitate a psychotic state, and therefore they were useful for psychiatrists as a training tool. And Leary, no, no, no. He wanted to say, no, 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 these so-called psychotic states are actually mystical states, and if you have the proper set and setting, that's what you can induce. So I was part of all that. So I was, you know, didn't know what to do, make of this, because nobody knew what consciousness was. I mean, that was the big rub. Okay, you expand it, yeah, I'll say, but you still didn't know what to make of it when it was expanded. Everybody was completely bewildered about what the hell all that meant. And Leary was very clever about it, because he finally realized that the mind is like a computer, and these are neural nets, and he anticipated the whole development of the internet, and you know, because he was wired. He got wired. He was a pioneer in thinking about things like that. And I was still wary of that, because I didn't think my mind was a computer. And especially now, this guy that I quoted, I won't even deign to learn his name. He talks on KQED, educational television, as a neurologist, and he calls the mind a computer made of meat. I mean, which is worthy of my hitting him. I mean, that guy should be hit for stuff like that.
Or, more technically, add insult to injury, a calculator made of fat substances.
Yeah, exactly. Which is even worse. So anyhow, I tried to define the nails that hammered in the lid on the coffin of vitalism. And when Earth Day hit in 1970, I was right in the middle of it. I mean, that to me was the neo-vitalist moment. We'd started the garden here 3 years earlier. I went on a canoe trip with Gaylord Nelson, who proposed Earth Day some month before he announced it. I didn't know then on the canoe trip that he was going to do that. But he was a great environmentalist from the state of Wisconsin, where we have a summer home, where we're going again in a week from today.
And you mentioned that the southern part of Wisconsin lacked trees.
Well, they cut up trees down everywhere. I mean, the whole state was eliminated as far as the forests were concerned. The lumber barons took down everything. And so it was Roosevelt's California... A Civilian Conservation Corps that reforested the entire north of the United States. So I go on this canoe trip with Gaylord. I had a friend that was close to him and got to meet him and know him. So he announces Earth Day. I said, okay, this is going to be it. No one really knew that it would be the kind of wake-up call that it was. It took root in practically every major municipality in the country. I used to have statistics about it, which are quite remarkable. And it was construed to be a teach-in, which was popular in those days. And it was a major moment. And so I thought, okay, now we have the initiation of the environmental movement. It had already been sounded by Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. That was really the first major call to wake up to what was happening to the environment because of the consequences of DDT on robin populations. And that happened in 1963 about. And then Earth Day, 1970, we got the garden ready to celebrate it in. And so, and then I had the worst thought I've ever had. That the environmental movement is the death rattle of defeated vitalism. Mm-hmm. The coffin came unglued after they pounded in the last nail. And the corpse of vitalism sat up and went, aah! For what, 50 to 75 years? What you say your own time frame for how much more time we've got, because it's all over. And so that's the worst thought I've ever had, to kind of condemn the environmental movement as the death rattle of defeated vitalism. That's how strong the physicalist takeover has been, and how clear we are in the late stage of the self-destruction of industrial society as a world above a given world of nature. So when I read Sheldrake's book, The Science Delusion, he tells the following story. When Sir Francis Crick died, one of the great physicalists, one of the you know, discoverers of DNA, his son gave his memorial address, in which he said, "My father's dying wish was to have driven in the last nail in the coffin of vitalism." Quote, unquote. Ha! Well, thanks, Francis. Now you're up the creek. So, I mean, you know, and I found quotes like that that just flabbergasted me because they're like handed to me on a plate. I start to think about how life has been excluded from modern science, you know, step by step, and that they really shouldn't call it the life sciences anymore. They should call it the death sciences. And then I read it in a book by a famous French philosopher of science, who's also a very famous and prominent practicing scientist, Atlan. And he quotes two physicists, Zentgiorgi and Yakov, saying there is no such thing as life. Life is not the possible object of scientific inquiry. Life isn't a concept. Okay. Yeah. I might have guessed it, but I didn't think any of you guys would say it. So, there we are, folks. So, as we said, Chadwick gave us a second chance, even though we knew we were in the midst of this catastrophe that is dawning and so hugely upon us. And the second chance has meant a lot for all of those who came under Chadwick's influence. I'm going to have Joe talk about compost some more, because it's a nice place to end up. So Chadwick left here, went to Saratoga. There's some controversy about whether he was fired or whether he just left. There's a current apprentice trying to figure it out and interviewing people who are still alive who were party to Chadwick's departure. And it looks like maybe he was in fact fired. I should know what happened to him, but I don't remember. All I know is he left. And that there was a major letdown as far as his being discouraged over the project here. He'd fallen out with one of his major apprentices who took over the farm which Chadwick had started, and Chadwick was kind of pushed back into the garden, and that in a way broke his heart. So he wound up sleeping on the floor of the garden chalet. There's a famous short story by Melville called Bartleby. Great existentialist story by the greatest novelist of American letters. And Bartleby winds up sleeping on the floor in the dead letter division of the post office. And so this is, I've got him a mattress and I got him a refrigerator. I even put in the lavatory facilities at the garden. But it was clear that he was coming to an end and that things were shutting in. So he left. He went to Saratoga, just over the hill, and he started a garden there. And it didn't work out quite on the first round. And then he went to Covelo, which I helped set up. No, he went to Green Gulch. I was a good friend of Baker Roshi, the head of the Zen Center in San Francisco. And he knew about Chadwick's work. And so he invited Chadwick to come and do the garden at Green Gulch Farm, owned by Zen Center. Joseph. So Chadwick did that. And that was a major effort. And it was still there. It's a wonderful garden. His major apprentice there has just written a fabulous book about the Zen Center garden. And so from Zen Center, they finally threw him out. He was an irritant to them. You know, he's subject to terrible rages. But he thought that they should garden more than they sat. Well, you know, they were pressing Zazen, which is sitting. So they disliked his pestering them about that. So he finally went to Covelo, which is the northern part of the state in Round Valley. It's a kind of a Shangri-La situation. And okay, and then you'll be back and you'll talk about compost?
Yeah.
Okay. So that was a major effort. It was sponsored by Richard Wilson, who was a wealthy rancher in Covelo. Round Valley, you come in and you drop into it, and it's about a 30-mile diameter valley, descended. You know, and it's surrounded by mountains. So it reminded me of Shangri-La. You couldn't have a more glorious environment. Only problem was, it was all rednecks. And they didn't like hippies coming up and do organic gardening. So they had a difficult time with it. The rednecks enjoyed walking over to a hippie at a football game and punching him out. So it was kind of an electric climate as far as trying to put the Chadwick Garden in there, but they got over that. And it was a success for quite a while, and Chadwick drew, whole crew of followers who wanted to study with him. It's kind of when his teaching flourished. He gave many lectures. We now have about 150 lectures that we're going to put up eventually, probably on the 50th anniversary of the beginning of the garden, which is 2-3 years from now. And so he finally contracted cancer of the, what do you call that?
Prostate? Prostate?
Yeah, prostate cancer. And left Covelo, but somehow wound up in West Virginia. There was a real strange guru named Paul Solomon. Both names assumed. St. Paul and King Solomon. That gives you an idea. The guy's ego. And he had a kind of belly to match. He had a kind of a basketball belly. And he ran this New Age hoo-hoo in West Virginia. And somehow they got a hold of Alan and they brought him to do their, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. They had these huge ambitions to do a big garden there. And Alan set about to do it, even though he was going to die within a year. So when I went out to see him, knowing he was dying, I asked Baker Roshi to bring him back to Green Gulch and to care for him until he died. They had a kind of hospice there for people as they were about to die. So Alan returned to Green Gulch and died there. And it was amazing because from his deathbed, he gave talks. And Jerry Brown was governor of California at the time. And I have this unforgettable image of Jerry Brown standing outside Alan Thor with his hat in his hand, waiting to go in to listen to Alan give one of his talks. So then he died and he was buried there. And that was that. And the Chadwick enterprise continued through his many apprentices. The garden farm here is still going strong with their agriculture.
And they're expanding.
Yeah, it's a really vibrant program, one of the best in the country for sure. And it's never been really integrated. I always called it an unintegrated appendage to the university. You go there for 6 months to do the training program and you get some kind of certificate, but you're not enrolled in the university per se. But that's worked, and so it's okay. And I was stunned to hear the chancellor. Somebody told me the chancellor likes talking about the garden. He says there are three major programs at the university that he's most proud of. The astronomy program, of course he is an astronomer. The genome project, which mapped the DNA. And the garden farm. What? So I once asked him, do you really say that? And he said, yes, I believe that. So, okay, that's nice. So, now what? Anybody?
You've won.
The chancellor doesn't say what you won.
Yeah.
It took all this time, but you got a chancellor to say that.
See, but here's what's
coming.
There's a chancellor saying, who are you to ask?
Yeah, really? No, get this one. So we have a reunion of apprentices at my home about 2-3 years ago. And about 15 apprentices come. Now they're all old now. Just odd to think. Well, it's 50 years later. And so we reminisced. And Mr. Webster, who has given $5 million to rebuild this stupid old barn that just got taken down. $5 million, I mean, what? Okay, that's gonna be expensive. And the Chancellor sees it as a way of reconfiguring the entrance to the university, and it'll be the showcase for the farm, which is right behind it. And the Chancellor, I think, even has that in mind. So I thought, okay, we want to put the Chadwick Archive in the barn and make it accessible to everybody. It's all digitized, it won't take up any space. NADA's going to do it. And so we have proposed it. Well, Mr. Webster came to this apprentices meeting because I wanted to kind of indicate to the apprentices that here was Mr. Webster with the big bucks, and he was willing to entertain the Chadwick Archive at the barn. And what he told me then was the following. He said, you know, you ought to be careful about what could happen. What? Monsanto will buy you. I still get kind of a chill in saying that. I said, what are you talking about? Well, he said, 10 years from now, let's say, Monsanto will take an interest in the Chadwick thing. They will open an organic division of Monsanto. And they'll give the university $10, $15, $20 million, and it'll be the Monsanto Alan Chadwick Archive.
Oh, my God.
Holy jumping Judas Priest.
At least they have created new breeds. New breeds, no GMOs, but breeds of nutrition enhancements, and it's patented.
Yeah, it's all patented. So I had to go to a board meeting of Richard Baker's Zen Center in Crestone, Colorado, and Mike Murphy is on the board with me. And Mike was the founder of Esalen Institute. You all know what that is, don't you? Yeah. And so he told me, hey, we just had a big organic meeting at Esalen. Why don't you invite me? Well, anyhow, they were all organic growers, about 15 of the main ones in the country. He said it was just fabulous. They had one of the best conferences at Esalen that they've ever had. And he said, and last week, guess who got in touch with me? Monsanto. I went, here it is. And I haven't followed up. I mean, he didn't quite know about it. He hadn't responded it yet, but he was going to. And it was obvious that they'd picked up some interest on what the conference has been on. Okay.
Well, hell, if you're Monsanto, that makes perfect PR sense.
Yeah, doesn't it?
Yeah, just like, you know, BP being the green company, trying, you know, like, it becomes...
And they can say, we are going to be the primary company in the world to overcome the physicalist-vitalist conflict. And we're going to, you know, do organic urea.
As the CEO,
and then piss on it will be the kind of logo of what?
Since you mentioned the organic urea again, I was wondering if you know whether the 20th century chemist Fritz Haber.
Yeah, I got your email and read it.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I've talked about him here.
Okay, was he a member of the Viennese Society?
No. He would have been close to the Physicalist Society in Berlin.
In Berlin.
And I don't know if he was an actual member, but he was, you know, in effect a colleague of Wohler. So he was part of that whole chemical development that was happening in Germany. And he carried on Wohler's work by virtue of, you know, developing the whole application to fertilizer. So he carried through what urea was as nitrogen, the fertilizer. Fritz Haber carried it through and made it universally applicable. And there was this huge production of fertilizer in Germany that went throughout the world as a consequence largely of Haber improving on Wohler.
So you could say that Haber is the godfather of the Green Revolution.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then it had its backlash in the sense that so many people were saved from starving that it contributed radically to the population problem. And Haber also applied ammonia, urea, synthetic urea was made up from ammonium cyanate, and Haber applied ammonia to artillery and made poison gas,
chlorine,
which was first used under his auspices in the First World War. And the email Barry sent me was how he witnessed the first application of poison gas and watched 5,000 soldiers die, just like that.
Yeah. He's known now as the father of chemical warfare.
And what was the thing that Einstein said about that?
Einstein said that all because he was totally appalled by people like Haber and Planck, and their enthusiasm for not only the war, but their enthusiasm, as you said, finding ingenious ways to effectively kill people.
But what was the line?
The line is quote, that because of all this, he said, all our technological progress is like an axe in the hands of a madman.
Mm. See, and the guy that taught here at some point, Rosenstock Quissy, was famous for me for saying, the sound of the axe is the natural philosophy of America.
And I read some bizarre news about the about nuclear weapons program that USA, Washington D.C. would move up, might move on to commit to first strike capacity against Russia and China.
That's good news.
Great.
Better get them first.
So just one more thing about Haber. Since I mentioned that the fact that many, after World War II, many of the plants for gas were retooled to make, they had all this nitrogen fertilizer type stuff laying around. So this is the beginning of the whole industrial fertilizer and the Green Revolution. And Haber seems to be directly responsible for
yeah,
that
you
also.
Said that.
Synthesis,
right.
Yeah.
So it should really be called the Synthetic Revolution rather than green.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And an industrial production, which is far from green.
I had a class that had the Green Revolution like as a definition that you need to know on a test, and like a lot of people got it mixed up with like the environmental
yeah,
movement.
Exactly.
Yeah, like, why is it the Green Revolution?
Yeah.
It's, I don't know.
I did too at the outset. I didn't know what they meant by that, and then it got exposed. So as an answer to words that have lost their coinage, that was another theme that came to me after finishing the book. I started to think about, okay, if they say life isn't a concept, and concept existence is not a predicate, and the logical positivist school wants to eliminate metaphysics, so being is and all such talk, what they call ontotheology. That's the combination of ontology and theology, meditation on being versus non-being, which is basic to Western philosophy. And spirit, what is that? And soul, okay, that's relegated to soul food, soul music, and soul what?
Soul train.
Huh? Soul what?
Soul train, yeah.
Soul train, no, that's good. I loved watching that. And so, you know, there it is. And what else? Oh, I had about 10 or 12 words that have lost their coinage. We even got down to vow. One time we were talking about marriage vows and how that's lost its coinage. You know, people tend to get married under the auspices of the, you know, this $10 certificate program where you can be a minister. Universal Life Church.
Yeah.
And they quote Khalil Gibran, you know, for the marriage ceremony. We'll be separate shores that never touch, which sounds a little worse than twin beds, and so on. So vow, you know, we had a really nice talk. I mean, I've married people, probably 50 people, 50 couples in the course of my career. I was a kind of a lay Lutheran. I mean, I have a degree from Harvard Divinity School, so that sort of set me up to do it. And the high point of the marriage ceremony is where you plight your troth. And I puzzled over that for some time, and I finally realized, oh, I get it. They give you the words to say, the meaning of which you don't know because you don't know what you're saying.
They force you to force it down.
No, they don't force it down. But it seems to me to be the wisdom of the marriage vow that nobody knew what they were saying. You know, plight your troth, they're archaic and obsolete. Well, plight, that's not too remote. I mean, that means put yourself in jeopardy. You know, plight, risk. And troth, that's an old word for truth and trust. So you risk your truth and your trust. You put yourself in jeopardy in making the vow to be married. And, you know, that's pretty much gone as far as people understanding what they're doing when they didn't understand what they were doing anyhow. At least you're given something to say that gave expression of that. Okay, so I tried to reintroduce the word, the ancient Greek word for soul and spirit, which is thumos. And that's a talk that Nada set me up to give for the TED talk. I picked up the word from my teacher Tillich, who wrote a book called The Courage to Be. We've talked about it to some extent here. And this is my solution to the demise of vitalism. We lost our soul. And it's partly because it's here and not here. Soul got identified with the mind.
The soul is the heart.
The spark, it's right here. And it's because thumos is associated with the herb thyme. It's thymus vulgaris in Latin. Thumos goes to thymus in Latin. And the thymus gland. So Tillich didn't know about that and wrote nothing about it, but I found it out. And I carried through his critique and analysis of thumos as the philosophical reflection on the courage to be, his translation of the word, and vital self-affirmation, which is another phrase he uses. And so I thought, okay, it is in this region. The thymus gland is the basis for our soul. If we think of ensouled, put an E-N before the word soul, ensouled, and add an E-D. And I don't know if there's such a term as inspirited, but there is such a term as spirited, which has a bodily implication. I had a horse, and he was very spirited. And so the word was perfect for talking about the vitality of my horse. And once in a while, you talk about a spirited woman. More so than men. Women are high-spirited. And so the word has some coinage there. But it's based here on thumos. I think women are high-spirited more than men because they're not so mental. And they have greater intuitive capacity. And it's because it's centered here. This is the centered self. And the location of soul and spirit based on the word thumos. So now Nada and I are going into the herbal business to make thyme products to exemplify the meaning of thumos. And one of our first products will be a thyme balm to rub on the thymus gland.
And perhaps you would benefit by adding a little philosophy mark.
I will. We'll have a little card that'll tell you all about that. So I'm going to pass around our thyme balm. We've made some already. And I will introduce you to your thymus glands in case you didn't know you had one. And it's the center of your immune system, so it's the defender of your courage to be and your vital self-affirmation. It's your first line of defense against anything that would make you sick. So, and it's only lately that I made the connection, which I hadn't made before. I knew about this, but I didn't connect it. Namely, that the immune system is based on the differentiation of self and not self. You guys know that? Have you ever heard of that? I mean, do you know anything about the immune system?
I think I'd heard that the little cells detect things that are like little foreign invaders.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's called antibody antigen. And the antigen is your foreign invader, and it's a clumsy word because it means antibody generating. And so you have antibodies to fight off any antigen that would attack you. And so it does that by differentiating between self and not-self. So I thought, well, then this is where we have our centered self, in our thymus gland, in our immune system. I mean, it's the basis for it. And it's a terrific connection. So I also made up a time spray. I told you guys I'm worried about students being intimidated. I think that's why one needs to teach with a whip. You're very passive. You don't show a lot of initiative. And, you know, you take it in, but it goes in one ear and out the other. That's my impression. And so you need to come out of your being intimidated to show initiative. And so I have this time spray, which I call the demystifier, to overcome your lack of self-confidence as far as being a student at a university. And this will do it. This will restore your self-confidence. I mean, it's just the best.
Add that to your time spray.
What? That's it?
Courage.
Yeah, that's the spray of courage.
On to the time spray.
I will.
It's good, huh?
I still think you ought to call it not ready before it's time spray.
Hurry up, please, it's time. My time is your time. So, I mean, isn't it odd that for purposes of public health, those few people know about their immune system and the significance of their thymus gland? So, did you guys know you had a thymus gland?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Huh? You all know that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Here.
And it's the major organ of your immune system. It programs your T cells, which are thymus cells. And you have a larger immune modality called B cells that work together with the T cells. So, anyhow, it's going to be fun to put these on the market. Okay, now I want to turn to Joe and have him give the hopeful resolution of my despair over the future that we're facing with compost piles that turn death into life.
Yeah, so you guys are a little bit familiar with biodynamics, and we went over kind of four of the basic principles that Alan York lays out, and that is that there must be biodiversity within the garden, that you keep a holistic system within the farm, that you keep as close as possible a closed loop system on the farm, which basically means that there's no essential waste, that everything is reused, that your waste stream becomes your fertility stream, and in that doing, you're able to take basically like all of these nutrients that have just been brought into this manure and into the dead matter, composting it to bring about new life for the next generation of your plants. And Rudolf Steiner, when he was talking about the biodynamic practice, he also laid out a number of preparations that go within your compost pile for a biodynamic compost. And I thought that today I would just go over the first one because each one can be a whole class of discussion, especially when we get into the philosophical underlyings of them. So the first prep that he speaks to, it's kind of been called BD500 for short, but it's essentially cow manure that has been placed into a cow horn and then buried in the ground and then is dug back up, and that manure has gone through a decomposition and fermentation process while inside the skull, that you just need a small amount of it to bring into the pile, and it kind of works as similar to homeopathics, where you just need a tiny little dose of it in order to get the full effect.
So almost like yogurt starter or sourdough starter?
Yeah,
kind
sure.
of, in a way.
It's like a starter.
Yeah.
How long is it buried for?
It's buried for a year. And so that, and that allows for the process for the horn to be buried with the manure to go through the entire life cycle process of the seasons.
And what happens?
And
can you describe it all? What
so,
turns it into something that makes it a starter?
Yeah, so it's decomposing within the cow horn, and so some of the reasons why Rudolf Steiner chose that was because if you look at a cow, the horn and the manure, you're dealing with the polarities of the cow. You're dealing with the head, which is where everything is coming in, and the highest point of the cow. And then you're dealing with the where the cow poops out the manure, and he looks at the manure as a gift to the earth from the cow, that this is what the cow has to offer for the earth. And so collecting that manure and putting it inside of the horn is encapsulating the entirety of the cow's essence, because you're dealing with the polarities. And so what he goes even further to say that it must be, that the manure must be harvested from a female lactating cow. And that is because when a cow goes into lactation due to giving birth to a cow, there's little rings that appear on the horns, and those rings signify an increase of nutrients that the cow is releasing, and those nutrients are going into the milk so that the newborn is able to have all of the nutrients that it needs in order to survive. And so he's also postulated from that that the manure during that time will also naturally be much richer in those nutrients. And so he takes that manure, puts it into the cow horn, and then just a small amount of it is used. Now, as far as what exactly is happening inside of that cow horn, I couldn't really say. But just from, like, I would love to try to figure out some way to do some sort of analysis with it. But then again, Rudolf Steiner did say at the very beginning of his agricultural course that biodynamics is for the doing individual and not for the thinking mind, because the way that our minds are set up, we are not logically capable of being able to kind of like explain everything that happens on this. Like, some of the things that happen in nature are beyond what we can mentally perceive.
Yeah.
Yes.
If you tried to figure out what it was and how it happened, then someone would try and make it synthetically. And then you would lose the life forces
yeah.
that were part of what was happening, it seems like.
Yeah, no, I think that would knowing the way humans work, that's definitely, someone would try that, I would say. And I think that just like when you spoke to the life forces, just like the life force of, because agriculture is naturally an exploitive process with the land, that by taking these biodynamic preps and bringing them into your compost pile, that's helping to restore the life force that is being removed from the farm through agricultural processes. I think it's really cool that with every single one of these preps, Steiner went through and found different archetypes. And so with the cow, the reason he chose the cow is because the cow is the archetype of digestion. Any manure that the cow is releasing has been through its four stomachs, and there is no other manure that is on this planet that is decomposed and digested to that level. And so bringing that manure in from a female lactating cow, in which all of its nutrients that it's been storing up for birth, all of those nutrients are being released at that time. And so then the manure can be brought into the cow horn, preferably the same from the same cow, and then dug. Because most cattle are naturally born with horns, but because they can be seen as like a danger, most of the cow horns are cut off. And so they can be harvested from a cow, but if ideally it would be done with cattle that are going to be eaten in a like shortly within a good time, and so then it's not stressful for the animal as well. that the practice of harvesting is done in a peaceful way for the cattle, just as much as like if we were being harvested, I would hope that it would be a peaceful process for me as well. Yeah.
To peaceably render the cattle unconscious quickly and safely, then disconnect.
That would be one way that you could do it, is, yeah, to somehow sedate them.
Calm them down, then render them unconscious, then disconnect.
Yeah, I mean, I personally haven't taken a horn off of a cow, so I don't know how it's done specifically.
I've looked up various ways of humane slaughtering. It's all about preventing the from experiencing suffering with consciousness.
Yeah, and so just speaking from that, like the way that, like I just raised 2 pigs last year, and the way that we chose to slaughter them was to just get food in front of them, and so they're eating the food and they're focused, and then it, with one bullet to just shoot right behind the neck, so that it severs the spine and the brainstem, and then they're out instantly. And they go, and I mean, honestly, that's the best meat that I've had. And so that would be an ideal way to do it. You can't harvest it from a young calf because the horns aren't developed. And so it needs to be from... process, except instead of using cow manure from a female lactating cow, it's silica, a quartz crystal that's been ground up and placed inside of the cow horn and then is buried for a year as well and then dug up, and that is mixed into a 5-gallon bucket of water and mixed in a special process with both sprays where you're putting your hands in. You want to do it with your hand because that's you engaging personally with the preparation and doing it in a vortex spiral. And there's been research done. There's actually, I'm trying to connect one of the physics professors here on campus with my friend Chris Tibbett, who owns a 200-acre biodynamic farm in Boonville. And he has flow forms and lemniscapes, which are essentially these designs that cause the water to do this vortex pattern. And what he's finding is that when water is in its natural state, such as when rain droplets are falling, when a wave is crashing, when a whirlpool is created, everywhere water is in a vortex. And even when we flush our toilet, we see that the water just naturally wants to go to vortex form. And so creating opportunities for the water to naturally flow in that form, he kind of looks at it as a water therapy. And he was the first person that I found I was doing that work. Since then, I've found a grad student here that's working with one of the professors. Can't remember her name right now. But she's trying to quantify the effects of vortexed water. And so that's another practice at many Waldorf schools that teach biodynamics. They have these flow forms and lemniscapes. And that kind of is to mimic the lemniscapes, mimic the natural tides. And so it's allowing the water to kind of shift back and forth like this, kind of almost creating an infinity pattern in a way. And then the flow forms are actually spiraling the water down. And the theory behind that is because all water has memory. And that has been shown through the research of the Japanese researcher who froze water droplets and looked at them under a microscope to look at the crystal formations of the water droplets. And what he found is that when he took a glass of water and projected his feelings of love and happiness and gratitude, that he was, and then would freeze a droplet of that water, he would find these perfect crystals within the form, these geometric structures that were just phenomenal. And then when he would take a glass of water that he would project anger and hatred into it, he would find that those crystal patterns had been disfigured and were just kind of, there was no geometric pattern to them. And so that suggests that water has some way of storing memory within it. And so what they're going to be doing research on is how does vortexing the water influence the memory capacity of the water, and in sort of like a water therapy.
So I got into that a little bit. I had the local franchise for the water forms that came from Emerson College in England, which is the Rudolf Steiner College. And I was invited to give talks there about 1976, and spent a month, a couple of weeks anyhow, at Steiner College, and met the guy that developed the whole flow form process and the sculpted forms for it. We put one in on the banks of San Lorenzo River. I don't even know what happened to it. And so it never really got anywhere beyond that. But there is a book called Sensitive Chaos. You know that book?
No.
And it comes out of the Steiner School. And it's all about vitalizing water through these flow forms. So it's an interesting development of a neo-vitalist approach to water and how to make water more vital. And that's what these flow forms are purported to do.
Oh boy, this must give a lot of fodder to, you know, us vitalists, you know, what we have to fight against, you know, like,
see,
when you first started, we're talking about, you got to take this and bury it in a cow horn, I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah,
and you bury it for a year, oh my God, you probably bury it under a full moon, oh my God, oh, then it's got to be a lactating cow, oh my God, and you got to do it with this, and then with the left hand, preferably with the pregnant woman doing it with the left hand from this direction, and it starts, even, and I'm a total believer in all that, and even I'm going like, God, this is a hard sell to myself.
If you speak to someone of the, who like, is a professor at the Rudolf Steiner College, they are much better at explaining these things.
No,
they'd
fine.
Say the same thing, and I'd still be believing
it's
it, hearing it, and going like, boy, that's, if that is an airy-fairy new agey, I don't know what is.
See, we just had a recap of it, because there was a famous book published, I don't know, 60s, 70s, called The Secret Life of Plants. And we mentioned it already here. The guy's name was Clive Baxter, not the author of the book. It was by Christopher Bird and his co-author, and they found this guy named Clive Baxter who had hooked up plants to a lie detector, and if he projected bad vibes on the plants, it would show up in a lie detector. Good vibes showed up on a lie detector, and it was discovered that plants were alive. Wow. It was an enormous breakthrough.
And some plants more than others, especially philodendrons for some reason. Go figure.
So now, that's just been reviewed. I mentioned the New Yorker article of about maybe a month or two ago by this famous writer, now Michael Pollan, who wrote The Omnivore's Dilemma, which was a fabulous account.
He also did Body and Desire.
Right down our line. And so he came to Santa Cruz to interview the botanist here, whom I've been connected with, I mean, through and a mutual interest in the so-called Voynich manuscript. But anyhow, he interviews the botanist to review what Clive Baxter did, and he was completely poo-pooed. I mean, it was ridiculous to think that any emotions that you had that you thought you could project to a plant, it's just crazy. And you can't even talk about plants being alive in the sense that Baxter wanted to and that other people wanted to. But then, when I asked if he would come to the class and talk about that, he said, well, I can't do it, I'm too busy, but I'm just working on a paper entitled, Are Plants Intelligent? Okay, you know, and then plants have an immune system. That was a big discovery for me. So anyhow, I'm sorry that I wasn't able to produce this guy, because he is, I think, a physicalist when it comes to botany. But he's still interested, at least in discussing, whether plants are intelligent. I thought, why can't you say something more like, are plants conscious rather than intelligent? That's even a further step than one might expect. But anyhow, that's that story.
Yeah, there's one example of living. Have you ever heard of living structures? One of them is a famous tree roots bridge somewhere in India, where each people have carefully constructed how the bridge shall be made using tree trunks and tree branches and roots. And that bridge has stayed alive for over 500 years, and it keeps growing stronger as they age.
Okay.
Yeah, and there's, in response to the plant intelligence, they've already been able to show that plants hold memory, and so in response to that, there's been a whole new field of research that's called plant neurobiology.
Right, that's what he's poo-pooing.
Yeah.
They have a big center for it in Italy.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's also detailed in Pollen's article.
It also reminds me of James Cameron's Avatar.
Okay.
Vitalism versus physicalism again.
Yeah.
Because with man-made fictional character Na'vi, where all forms of life, the trees, the plants, neuroconnectors, reach from humans to other creatures versus corporate military that wants to extract it to resources.
Mm-hmm.
It may play the familiar story a bit. It strongly resonates of James Cameron's Avatar.
Okay.
I'd like to ask Chris a question about the water vitalization. Beyond that, are people already thinking of ways that this technique and burgeoning pollution of the water supply, can that technology or budding technology be applied to cleaning up rivers and other places?
I'm not sure.
I think so. It's been attempted. There have been some applications in Holland. And also in buildings, where they have flow forms in buildings to do a vitalization of the water.
I think it's also combined with other filtration processes. Because just the act of the vortexing itself helps with a specific part of the revitalization of the water, but I think that there's also just like filtration process that's also required to get some of the larger physical like contaminants that may be in it, such as plastic.
So it could be used in tandem with the filtration.
Yes.
So
yeah.
You should get in touch with Rob Abraham, the mathematician here, because he's party to all this kind of stuff.
Okay.
I looked up Vital Waters, a company that a leader in alkaline drinking waters.
And they use flow forms for that?
Stable alkaline infused bioavailable materials, imperfect for maintaining a healthy lifestyle. Bottle at pH 8.640 alkaline.
Hmm.
Yeah, there's, I don't know if it's the same thing that you're talking about, but Chris Tibbett, the same person who owns the biodynamic farm, was told by a Western medical doctor that he was supposed to die 5 years ago, and then he went to an alternative doctor, and they developed a process in which he vortexes his own water for, I think it's 27 minutes, and then just drinks that, and that's been keeping him alive for now.
What was he supposed to die from?
It had to do something with his, I believe it was his kidney or his liver, some sort of organ.
That's what I wholly hate about it. I wholly hate it. The idea is like, Odo, we're going to take away your stuff. Death means we'll take more of it. It's like, Odo, there's nothing you can do because they're trapped in single-minded approaches. It's
seek a second opinion.
Yeah.
So, Chris.
Joe.
I'm sorry, Joe.
Yeah.
Could you explain again how your friend who has this farm
Tibbetts
vortexes the water? Because I'm wondering if it would be a simple application that could be in every home. That, you know, you could.
Well, you should
show
Google,
you some
Google Sensitive Chaos, you know, in terms of the book, it's about all this. And then you'll probably be able to pick up by Googling it various measures that you can take to vitalize water. So
yeah.
There's a field for that. But it comes off the Steiner sensitivity.
But it's not expensive.
No.
Proposition.
No. And the flow forms themselves were simply concrete forms, that, and they were inexpensive. And they do the trick because of this vortex pattern.
Wait, can we plug this into a projector?
Well, don't bother with that now.
I can just show
it wouldn't
you.
Be that.
This is kind of what this is his
design. So, do you have another question?
Just the way you lay out your.
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I was just saying that book, The Secret Life of Plants,
yeah.
They talk about a lot of studies regarding that vortex
yeah.
process happening in the human circulatory system. And it sounded like there were applications for that
okay.
to what we can do.
And I also meant to mention the sequel to that, which is called The Secrets of the Soils. So they followed up the Secret Life of Plants by going around to find people who were adept at composting and creating the most fertile soil. And they hit upon a guy I had met the same time I met as Clive Baxter. It was a funny coincidence. His name is Callahan. And he had discovered that if you add pulverized granite to soil, it enhances soil fertility. And so they have a whole chapter on him in The Secrets of the Soils. And he was lots of fun to meet. And he's the guy that had detected the monopole. I went through that a little bit. He probably didn't pick it up because I thought that was my answer to the physics for a life force. But that's Callahan. And he applied the monopole to crush granite in soil through a process of logical discovery.
Did Clyde Baxter do The Secrets of the Soils too?
No, he's just in The Secret Life of Plants.
Okay, Secret to the
But Phil Callahan is the guy that detected the monopole and also applied crushed granite because they're monopole attractors to soil fertility. And he's a hoot. So do you know anything about Callahan and monopole attractors, Joe?
No.
That's something to add to your arsenal. So there is a book called The Secret of the Soils by the same guys that did The Secret Life of Plants, Bird and somebody. And in a chapter on Callahan, I think it's Phil Callahan, they talk about how he discovered how crushed granite functioned as a monopole collector. And he'll detail that for you because the monopole for us is the physics of the life force. And you should read what he's published by U.S. Acres Today, I think it's Acres Today, is the publishing company for our kind of stuff.
Okay.
And they publish Callahan.
Okay.
Acres Today?
Yeah, USA Acres Today. And they have about four or five books by Callahan. Okay.
And so another thing that I thought I would speak to just briefly is because of this need for kind of therapy, I think across the entire species is we've kind of been pushed into this kind of an individualistic lifestyle where we need to become strong individuals, which is kind of leads to this antisocial interaction that I've been noticing is becoming stronger and stronger between individuals just on like passing by. It's like there's less and less conversations being had. And so one practice that is being implemented here in Santa Cruz at the Camp Hill Communities, which is up in SoCal. Camp Hill Communities was also started through Rudolf Steiner's work, and it's specifically set up for people who are experiencing some sort of mental disability. But I think the concepts that are used within the space could be applied anywhere. They create therapeutic biodynamic gardens in which they're working with Goethe's color theory, but through the plants. And so you're working with complementary colors of how you create kind of like rooms within your garden where each little space is working with complementary colors. So if you have a purple blossom, you're also working with a yellow blossom that comes in at the same time. So you can really experience these distinctions, and so that it can create kind of like a color therapy practice. And you're working with Same how there's musical keys where certain notes sound good together. Same concept with color keys, how there's certain colors that aesthetically work better together and are more pleasing to the eye. And so creating your entire garden in such a way that as you have an experience of walking through this garden, it's a healing experience. It allows you to open up to reconnect with the beauty that nature has to inherently offer for us, instead of just like the exploitation that we constantly take part in every day. Therapeutic gardening gives you an opportunity to just walk back through the garden, and it's created in a space in which the pathways are just enough for two people to walk side by side so that interactions can be cultured in that space. And each part of the garden is kind of set up so that if there is an interaction between human beings, that it's kind of feng shuied in such a way that it wants to be more of a healing interaction. So there's things that can be talked about. If you have nothing to exchange between an individual, it can be just appreciating the plants that are growing nearby. Biodynamics also talks about this relationship between the pathway and the bed. And what they say is that the pathway is from the present moving into the future. And that is the path that the gardener travels. And the garden bed is from the present into the past. Because the way that the garden bed is producing is based upon how the gardener was a steward for that land, for that part of the earth in the past. And so you can really just go across the entire time spectrum just by walking along a pathway. You can experience the past, the present, and the future within the garden. And so I think that that's an also a really amazing concept to kind of think of, that the gardener is not necessarily creating the garden, but is a steward of the garden and is able to not necessarily take ownership of the plants, but to come and offer oneself to the plants of like, what can I do for you? I know that with plants, they don't have the ability to move around. They don't have opposable thumbs. They've developed an incredible ability to take carbon and photosynthesize it into oxygen, which is the strongest symbiotic relationship that plants have with all animals that can walk the earth. And this is a relationship that's gone back since the beginning of photosynthesis, which happened a couple billion years ago. So this is a relationship that we've been developing with plants for generations and generations. And so being able to gain awareness of that connection and really just tune into the gardening practice. Because by gardening, you're doing something that humans have been doing for thousands of years. And kind of how you spoke to with the herbs.
The herb code.
Yeah.
Same that it's talked about in biodynamics, that there's also kind of a gardener's code. And I thought about that when you said that there's an herb code that's kind of worked in with the DNA of the human species. Similar that when gardening, Steiner talks about being able to tap into a collective knowledge that is being built through generations of gardeners. And so just being able to, I think a lot of it is going into a garden with an open mind in that way, that there is a possibility that intuition or some sort of guidance can come to you, be it through a channel through yourself or a channel of you interacting with the plants in such a way that sparks a recognition that can be acknowledged, I think. And let's see. So I think the man who, David Schwartz, is the gardener for Camp Hill Communities, up in SoCal, and kind of he breaks down the garden as there's six main aspects of the garden. There's the gardener, the land, the plants, the design and form, the tools, and the walk plan. And what he says is one of the most important aspects of it is the walk plan, because how do you want to interact with your garden? The plants are going to be growing, and there's not much you can do to control them except for pruning. So the main part that you can control in the garden is, where do you want to create pathways? Where can you walk? And so using that opportunity to create energetic channels through the garden So kind of like, is anyone familiar with the term of geomancy?
Mm-hmm.
So kind of in that same respect of geomancy is allowing, creating these pathways that kind of help to cultivate and enhance the energy that's within the garden. And so really just like creating plants with spirals, like herb spirals are a great way to kind of just like bringing all of these herbal essences and just spiraling them up into the space and the spirits that work within the land, because Rudolf Steiner spoke a lot about the unseen world just as much as the seen world. So creating energetic portals in which the energy and the essence of the plants can be brought up, kind of like a toroidal field might just be circulating throughout your garden, kind of using that concept and using spiral forms, Fibonacci sequences, and sacred geometry within your garden plan to help enhance the energetic flow of your garden and how you walk through the garden. Because he speaks a little bit about, like, as you are walking through, you are leaving little parts of yourself everywhere you go. And that little, and that's through an unseen energetic aspect. And so how do you want to create those patterns that you walk through your garden? I think that that's just, like, when I heard about that, that was just a really cool thing to open up my mind to, is to really think about that. Like, kind of going beyond the idea of the feng shui of the garden, but really just, like, thinking, like, okay, if I walk into this area of the garden, what pulls my attention immediately? Where do I often always look when I walk into this room? And David Schwartz has found that through that practice, that many people are pulled to the same thing within a garden. And so how do you make that first thing that grabs your attention a very welcoming and opening space so that you can feel really comfortable within the garden? And then that comfort, through the work of Cleve Baxter, suggests that you're not only creating comfort within yourself, but you're creating comfort within the entire garden, which creates a space in which all of the plants can feel completely healthy and welcomed and can flourish. And so I think that's another just amazing. Yeah.
I just want two things. One, I just wanted to say that if anybody hasn't walked through Paul's garden, I'm talking about his garden here, the garden in his backyard of his house, I got a chance to do that for one of our seminars, and I found it, I don't know, his mojo feng shui must have worked in the right way, because I found it, I went back there and I was walking around and I just got this very healing, peaceful energy. Has anyone else experienced that?
Well, we ought to do it, Charlie. We haven't been in the backyard for about a year.
Maybe anyone can join up this upcoming Friday for a little tour.
Yeah, you're welcome to come. Yeah. Are you going to come at 3?
Yeah, I'd be happy to come at 3 o'clock
okay.
on Friday.
So come down and we'll have
bring
a little garden
papers.
Party.
Bring your papers.
So what Chadwick introduced me to were clairvoyers and avenues, I mean avenue. And clairvoyers are this kind of ley line that you get, almost a mystical line that you can get through landscapes. And avenues are avenues that are often planted with chestnuts or linden in Europe. And my wife and I went to the formal garden called Saint-Germain, just overlooking Paris, and they have a line of chestnut trees that made me weep. I mean, I started to cry a little bit because Chadwick was so enamored of such scenes in a garden, and here it went on as though for infinity. And there is a book called Gardens of Infinity about how French formal gardens were planted to give the illusion of infinity, where you have a kind of unending line of view with respect to how the garden has been designed.
It's so like almost like a circle.
So, are you done? I got to wrap up this, and I have just a few things to say about the end. Okay, thank you so much for that.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks. Thank you guys for listening.
So I end up the book with a terrific discovery, because here was Rachel Carson, who wrote Silent Spring, and I credit the Ballad of Cock Robin. And I kind of was inspired to take the Ballad of Cock Robin from her work and make it the pattern for the course. You know, who killed Cock Robin? Vitalism. I said the sparrow. Physicalism with my bow and arrow, artificial synthesis of urea. will be Chief Mourner. I said the dove, existentialism, because of my love. And then I've even added a line, which my wife kind of reminded me of. Who saw him die? I said the fly with my little eye. I saw him die. That's Rachel Carson. So I could include her in her own ballad. Wow. And all the birds in the sky fell to sighing and a sobbing when they heard of the death of poor Cock Robin. I'm going to ask you all to sing this at the end of the class, because I've been waiting for you all to sing the ballad with me to conclude this class. So I'm reading a biography of Rachel Carson, and I hit upon the narrative where, do you all know the name Dr. Spock?
Yes.
He was a famous baby doctor.
Benjamin Spock.
Benjamin Spock, and he wrote something about child care, baby care. Became the Bible of our generation and when our daughter was born. And he was totally benign. I mean, you don't punish, you don't spank. You know, you just be as sympathetic and as, you know, identify in the most sympathetic emotional way with your child as you can. And he had one rule of thumb where if your baby cries, you don't go and attend to it, you let it cry. And the first night the baby will cry for half an hour. You may not be able to stand it, but you got to let it go. Second night, the baby will cry for 15 minutes, and the third night, the baby won't cry at all. And so we did that, and it worked just exactly. Yeah,
and I remember I remember it when I had visited in Chicago or somewhere when Katie, my half-sister Katie, felt very worried about her first daughter, Annalise. She was crying a lot, and then one of her relatives advised her that her long crying means that she'll be proud of it. Try to convince her to just leave the baby alone to cry. It will become more complacent.
And it worked.
And the guy who was representing around the same time as Spock lived, representing the physicalist, behavioralist side, was B.F. Skinner, who said,
right,
you put the kid in a box.
Well, and then when the baby cried, you turned up the heat.
Right. So
and that was positive reinforcement.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Spock's sister, Marjorie, was a follower of Rudolf Steiner. And she went to Dornach to study biodynamics at the Steiner Center. And she came back to Long Island and, with her companion friend, developed a biodynamic garden on Long Island. And they started spraying DDT to combat the mosquito population. And sometimes two or three flights a day would come over in Long Island dropping DDT on her biodynamic garden. So she had a fit. So she called one of her best friends, who was a botanist and a naturalist, and complained to her. And the friend started doing research on DDT to see how destructive it was. And Marjorie took the case to the local court, lost, took it to the next court, lost, took it to the state court, lost. It finally went to the Supreme Court. And their friend, who was a scientist, followed them all the way through, giving them the scientific data for why DDT was so destructive and it just needed to be stopped as a procedure. It was Rachel Carson. And I was reading this in bed, and I almost fell out of bed. Oh, because here's Rachel Carson, who's assisting a biodynamic gardener in combating DDT and singing the ballad of Cock Robin. And so it created a loop for what we did here with Chadwick and biodynamics. So that was a wonderful thing to discover. Okay, we're almost done, and we're about to sing the ballad. Is there anything anybody wants to say in the next couple of minutes? Who killed Cock Robin?
Who killed Cock Robin?
I said the sparrow.
I said the sparrow.
With my bow and arrow.
With my bow and arrow.
Who'll be Chief Mourner?
Who will be Chief Mourner?
I said the dove because of my love.
I said the dove because of my love.
Who saw him die?
Who saw him die?
I said the fly with my little eye.
I said the fly with my little eye.
I saw him die.
I saw him die.
And all the birds in the sky felt a sighing and a sobbing when they heard of the death of poor Cock Robin. When they heard of